Good morning, everyone. You know, we've heard a lot lately about those people who put their lives on the line for us, soldiers, police, fire. And there are others who are there at times when a life hangs in the balance, trying to save lives and care for the sick and injured. They provide emergency medical services. And we want to learn more about those men and women who are involved with EMS, as it's known. Our guest this week is Katie Hill. She is EMS coordinator for Iowa Health Des Moines. She's a registered nurse, works with the Life Flight Air Ambulance Program at Methodist, and is very active in the Iowa EMS Association, EMT certified as well. You have more letters after your name.
There's a lot of alphabet soup after my name. That's right.
Thanks for coming in. Tell us, let's start with the big picture. What is EMS? What are emergency medical services? Because I know it's kind of an umbrella term.
Yes, emergency medical services encompasses numerous levels of care providers. There's several scopes of practice is what we call them, and that pertains to the skill and the types of treatment that you are authorized to provide when you come upon a sick or an injured patient. And that ranges all the way from a first responder that may just arrive on scene first before anyone else gets there, and they provide just the basic life-saving care and stabilization until a more advanced emergency medical technician or paramedic arrives. And those are the people that typically will provide more advanced care and do the transportation of those patients to a hospital or
Give us an example of what's the difference, for example, between an EMT and a paramedic, because we hear those terms so much, but I'll bet you most folks don't know the difference.
Well, an EMT can provide basic services. They can do CPR, stabilization of a trauma patient, say for their neck and spine, help with the patient as the fire departments or the extrication teams are getting them, say, out of a vehicle that's damaged. And then they can monitor the patient and do certain, I would say, more basic health care initiatives if they were to transport the patient. And whereas a paramedic, those people can give a plethora of medications. They can make treatment decisions based on, you know, extensive training and knowledge and background. And they function off protocols that their medical director provides to them that allows them to take care of these patients in a much more advanced method.
It certainly is gratifying to know that these people are out there if we need them, but let me, you know, kind of go back not too far in history, because it seems like this is a relatively new development. It wasn't that long ago that ambulances and emergency medical services, so to speak, were provided by somebody who drove a taxi or worked at a funeral home where they just happened to have an ambulance.
Yes, in the first half of the century, ambulance transportation was done by the funeral homes, and that's purely because they had the hearse. Mm-hmm. That was the only vehicle that was available where you could lay the patient down, and so they were basically just providing transportation. They would get called out, they'd arrive on scene, and they'd take you to the hospital, but they really didn't provide medical care en route.
And what changed?
Well, in 1966, the Department of Transportation was initiated, and that helped states begin to have the regulatory standards and some funding to start to build more of an emergency medical system where you would have more standards, more guidelines, and more training.
And whether it's a heart attack or an accident or something like that, that first medical attention that you get is often the most crucial.
It really is, because, you know, we all know if you've ever taken a CPR course or first aid course, you know, you gotta protect the airway and the breathing and the circulation. And then those people come in and they provide that very first hands-on care to open the airway, to help stabilize that patient. And you know, bystanders don't always have the training necessary, although we're trying to do lots of community education, and that's another big part of emergency medical services is working in the communities.
And let's talk about that after we take a break, but right now we're out of time for this segment, but we will be back with Katie Hill talking about EMS when Newsmaker continues.